morning, educators, and namaste, educators. One week ago, we had a essay competition, and the topic was my dog. And as I was going through the winner's list, I saw one essay which was very identical to another essay. I went to the child and asked, the topic was my dog, and your essay is very similar to that of your brother's. How come? Did you copy? The child said, no, sir, we have the same dog. That's why it's same. We have the same dog. Friends, after that, I was passing through the corridor. I saw a science teacher asking a student, where is your science textbook? The child said, it is at home, madam. What is it doing at home? I don't know, but I'm sure it is having a better time than me. At least it is safe at home. I'm just lighting the moment. Friends, every day morning when I travel all the way to Kengeri, I throw a challenge at myself. Can I see a person and identify whether this person is a teacher or not? I throw a challenge at myself because it's 8:30. That's the time we all teachers are out there, ready to go. And what are my yardstick through which I gauge? First, it has to be a woman. Look around. Okay, majority of women. I appreciate the men, but majority of women. Wearing a well-ironed sari, well-made sari. Wearing a vanity bag. But you may say, most of the women morning could be wearing the sari and thing. But in their eyes, I can see the stress. The stress of whether I have completed my LP. Have I given it to my coordinator? Is my question paper draft ready? Have I finalized my question paper? Have I got it corrected? Is it Xeroxed? The stress is a typical identity of a teacher. Unfortunately, I know teaching is a very, very stressful job. And one of the reasons why we initiated Namaste Educator is to call you all and say it's okay. Just sit down, relax, and laugh for a while. It's all okay. We can also laugh. We can also smile and relax for a while. That's why we have a very hilarious comedy drama coming up. So that you don't think about your mundane stuffs. Weekend. Weekends sometimes are so weak at their ends. I understand. The agenda is just to make sure that you relax. In fact, in Chitrakuta, we take it so seriously to make teachers relax. Very contradicting English words. So seriously to make teachers relax that we actually take them on a two-day trip in the month of July so that we have all the newcomers, new teachers also part of us. And in July, we take them to Chikmagalur or Coorg or Shivamogga. After the 2 days, they relax. Last time we were in Coorg, I want to narrate an incident. So it was drizzling. Everybody were rain dancing and shouting and howling. They were having fun. Only teachers, no family members. Only teachers, all right? There was one teacher looking at the sky, holding her hands like this. Very poetic. It was very curious. I went to her and said, what, are you all right? She said, sir, I'm overwhelmed. I'm very happy. Very interesting. What is that which made you very happy? Sir, being a teacher, a concept that I can wake up at 8:30 in the morning, I am not able to digest it. Today I woke up at 8:30 in the morning. Right? And I come out and just sit down seeing the sunrise. Sunrise! That's something I've never seen for years. I'm seeing sunrise, and then, above all, somebody is making a coffee for me? My good God! Is it my dream? Am I in reality? No children to get ready, no, nothing to cook, nothing to run to catch bus. So we deserve to relax. I don't know why teaching has become a stressful journey. I don't know. Unfortunate. Very, very unfortunate. You know why? I strongly believe teaching is majority of dramatizing and reaching out, Content is another 10%, 20%. The rest of is your presentation, how effectively you reach. So I strongly believe in sending our teachers to a drama class, or to watch a drama, or to see a magic show, then go to a teaching workshop. It's very important for them to learn probably these skills so that they can reach out more effectively than probably going to... Honestly, we need to be creative. So if that is so, we need to be relaxed. If you are not relaxed, we definitely cannot do that. Somebody made a statement which has made a very deep impact in me. The future of the country lies inside the classroom. The future of the country is defined inside the classroom. Man, very scary line, because we are all teachers. Very scary line, giving us so much of power. It is not in the legislature, it's not the politicians. The future of the country is defined inside our class, when I am teaching, when you are teaching. Here we are 400 very, very powerful people. I'm addressing powerful people. As Spider-Man says, with power comes responsibility. Unfortunately, with power comes responsibility to be a right catalyst in making it happen. You know, about a year ago, we wanted 2 accountants. So I put an ad, walk-in interview at 4:30 for accountants. I thought, well, maybe 5-7 people would have come. And I carelessly went at 4:30. There I see a marriage kind of a festival. I could not believe. I thought something is wrong. I was looking around. And then I realized all these people have come for interview. And there were 143 candidates. I'm alone. Right? I'm alone. There were 143 candidates. I had to start. It was already 4 o'clock. I calculated. I'm an engineer, so quick in calculation. So if I take 2 minutes, by 11 o'clock I will be out at night. Per head if I take 2 minutes. So I can't even afford 2 minutes. Perfect. I came out with 2 yardstick instantaneously, creatively. I will ask them to introduce themselves in 3 lines. And I'll ask them a question. If a student scores 40 marks out of 50, what is the percentage? I will ask these 2 questions. How many of them answer? I will continue my interview. One was checking their communication. One was, do you want to call it analytical? A common sense, whatever you call it. I will tell you the statistics you will not believe. Out of 143, only about 8 of them could answer the question, if 40 is scored out of 50, what is the percentage? And very awkward thing is 50% of them strongly felt, sir, it is 90%. I don't know from where they got this 90 figure. 50% of them said 90%. If you want, try it out. Catch hold of 10 people. Ask them this question. What is 40 out of 15 percentage? Though it was a matter of interview, that was an awakening moment for me. All these students had done mostly BCom. They all had degrees. They all had carried a Xerox copy of their marks card. Most likely first class or second class. That means there was some teacher who taught them as well, like me. It was a very big question mark, very big awakening question mark. Hundreds of candidates, forget about recruiting them. I don't even feel like interviewing them. I don't even feel like interviewing them. That reflects on some teacher somewhere, sometime back. That might reflect on us some days later. If we continue to send people with 10 CGPI and beautiful marks cards, and if they are not recruitable, if they are no value addition for themselves or for others, somewhere something is going wrong. This is some constructive discontentment I always suffer. The life skill. This marks card is not giving the life skill. Now let me tell you a statistics. For all you know, your coordinators and principals might have scored lesser than most of the teachers who are sitting here. A secret. Could have. It's okay, because it is not the marks who is going to decide, it's the life skill. ability to manage people, ability to plan, ability to manage the emotion, ability to dramatize your ideas. There is quite a lot of stuff needed to succeed. The marks card alone won't. So this gives a lot of priority, lot of responsibilities on the heads and the head of the institution to create life skill inside the students. Something beautiful happened last week. I can use the word beautiful for it. What happened? Right behind there is a room. Right next to it there is a science lab. Few of our 10th standard boys got curious. They wanted to see whether phenyl can catch fire. They got curious. So they took a small quantity from somewhere, went to the toilet, put it there and put the fire. Thank God nothing happened as such. There was no much damage or anything. But that was an act which could have been very dangerous. And today, schools are more like inspectors. There is nothing which can go out of our sight. There are 100 odd cameras everywhere. So it was very easy. Within 2 minutes, we got to know who were the students who put fire and when, which time, what were the dress they were wearing. We had all the statistics with us. And now the question is, what punishment to give to them? What is the punishment we need to give to them? Favorite thing, let us cut all the co-curricular classes, right? First. Let us cancel the trip. How else can you punish them? If you suspend them, maybe they are going to be happier. They may feel like motivated, maybe. Parents are also party for it. How come they were so ignorant in their behavior? So how do we penalize the parents? Okay, let's have a penalty of 1,000 rupees per child for the act what they have performed. When this discussion was happening, I was sitting on the chair thinking, there is a third party we are missing. That is school. How are you going to penalize the school? We are equally responsible for why the children did this act. How can we excuse ourselves when we are punishing the rest? So what is the penalty school is going to give? A very, very tricky situation we schools are at.